We are totally pros.
Hi, everybody.
It's been so long.
Christy, I've missed you. It's been like a full hour, and we were on the phone most of that hour.
We were on the phone, Be Live, and Zoom at the same time, trying to get this ready for y'all because we just finished this most amazing thing. So you have to know we're a little bit punchy. Maybe we always are, but today we really are.
Today might be really bad, but it might be more entertaining because it is a Friday and this is a good time to go live.
Right.
So we're here today to tell you all about kind of an experience we've had and then offer this experience to you.
Yeah.
I would say, I'm not kidding you, this has probably been the best experience of the year around professional development.
Well, it is. You are living in a pandemic, so.
I'm going to even stretch the year to not just include the pandemic.
Okay. That makes me feel better because I'm like, I'm better than a pandemic.
We're like a lot better than the pandemic. A whole year of all the kinds of PD I've done, this one is it. And it's for paraprofessionals. And it's the two of us. Thank goodness, Christy, it's the two of us. It's the two of us with, we had 700 plus paraprofessionals in a class for the past four Fridays. And we have been spending these Fridays together with them. In fact, today, what did that one paraprofessional say? She wrote on Facebook, yay, I look forward to Friday professional development, right?
Yeah, it was so whatever. It was profound what she said. We'll just paraphrase, but she's like, yeah. I look forward to PD on Fridays. And that, when I read it, I was like, said no one ever, but yet these paras say it all the time. Like they can't wait to hang out with us. I do have a couple of things that they've been saying. I'll show, well, let's do three of them real quick and then we'll tell them what we're doing.
Yeah. I'll read it for those of you who are just, not watching. This class was awesome. It reinforced things I already do and showed me how to improve my actions. So that's from one of them. This other paraprofessional who's in our course said, I am loving these courses. Thanks for making the content so thorough and practical for us. And I'm gaining so much information. I'm glad I signed up. Those are three examples of real testimonials from the real folks that have just been in this class with us. And so you might wonder, what is it like? It's so fun. So it's the two of us.
We're very put together.
Yeah. Pretend we're put together. That's what it looks like. And we're put together, or as put together as we ever are. And we have provided for them four classes that they come and watch. And by watch, I mean participate in too, because we've got the chat. It's actually very interactive. And we make sure every class to teach them something new, to offer a bunch of strategies and offer a bunch of tools, and then answer questions and things like that. So it's really good training for any paraprofessional working in any system in any school.
Yeah. And we thought we'd show you a couple of things that we've been teaching, because a lot of people have been like, what do you guys talk about? Or the paras in the class are like, oh, everybody needs to know this. Or like, you know, Ashley Lyons and I were talking after one of the sessions, and you know, Ashley just about has her PhD in early child special ed, and we were still learning stuff. So do you want to do the roller coaster or the ladder? Which one do you want to do first? Yeah.
Let's just start with the ladder, because some of you probably don't even know about the ladder within the ladder. So we're just about to blow your mind. Okay, paraprofessionals. Good. Yeah, so paraprofessionals are often working on helping kids become more independent. And probably the number one challenge that I hear from administrators and parents is, how do we help paraprofessionals really fade their support? So in one of the classes, we shared the prompting ladder, and I'll share that. And then if you want to share the visual prompting ladder, just to blow their mind further, Christy. But what we tell people to do on the ladder is to start at the very bottom and provide the least intrusive supports that you can. And then imagine that you're afraid of heights and you only go up as far as you need and return down as quickly as possible.
I think that's what was so helpful, Julie, is when you gave that, like, pretend that you're afraid of heights, because it made us all go, right, I'm not going to stay here or seek to go higher. I'm going to go only as far as absolutely necessary.
Yeah. And then return down as quickly as possible.
Yeah.
And so for why we love this particular tool is because if you're a student and you're being supported by a paraprofessional, you are going to get someone who's trained to really look to make sure that they're being the least intrusive support possible. So starting at the bottom with invisible materials, meaning we provide invisible supports for people or just change the materials, all the way up to natural cues, which would be like what cues exist in the environment to have somebody do a task or wait time or gesture, all the way up to visual prompt. And then when we were talking in our class, we talked about the fact that actually visual prompting has its own ladder. Yeah, so do you want to describe that?
And it's a little bit awkward because, as Julie was saying, the ladder, the blue ladder goes from least intrusive to most intrusive, or least supportive to most supportive. It's kind of different words. Mm-hmm. But when we think about visual supports, and I first learned this from my colleague, Barb Avila, that as humans, we're both developmental specialists, so we love anything that's a developmental hierarchy, that mm-hmm. was sort of like this idea that the actual object is more supportive. It's not so much this intrusive or anything negative. It just means from a developmental perspective, if you're young or if you're really struggling, going to the top of the ladder gives the learner the most support. So meaning if I do the actual object and I show you, Julie, do you want beer or wine? And I show you the beer and the wine, that's mm-hmm. easier than if I gave you a menu that had the word beer and the word wine on it. So yes. Depending on your mental state even, you yes. might need more support. And so a student could feel like they're struggling with the visual prompt, and you might think, oh, I need to do verbal or physical or hand over hand. But really what you need to do is go the ladder inside the ladder and give better or more supportive visual support.
Well, one thing I love that you said is like beer or wine example is so perfect for me at this moment, right? Both of our minds are absolutely fried. We've been doing these classes and so the idea, sometimes the words are even gone, right? But yeah. If I could actually see that or that, you know, that's what I want. Right. And it's not a permanent decision. It can be just temporary based on where a student is at the moment or how overwhelmed their system is or how tired they are, how sick they are, or how blah, blah, blah. And so the fact that that's there and available so that we're teaching paraprofessionals to make good decisions with a lot of supports for them, really.
And to be really dynamic is what you're saying, so that they don't feel like they have to do. I see so many people feel like it's my job to do hand over hand support. And hand over hand is at the top of the ladder. Like unless the kid has significant cerebral palsy or lack of mobility or is missing an arm, for goodness sake, right. There's no reason that we should be moving other people's bodies.
Yeah, I saw hand over hand dancing recently and I was just like, nope. So we had to back that support. And it wasn't with bad intention. It was just someone who wanted the student to be so involved. And so we figured out by just walking down the ladder where we could provide the support. In this case, we ended up using peer support. And just think about when you're dancing with a partner, how that is in a way hand over hand, but much more appropriate than paraprofessional helping this kid dance. Right.
So that's one of the big things that we talked about. Maybe we'll show them the graphic record from the IEP week.
Oh, that'd be so cool.
Let's do that.
Okay.
One. Okay.
Yeah. I'll talk this through. This is from Cheryl Kniezel. And if you don't know who she is, you should. And she has a website called Meaningful Marks. But Cheryl's been taking graphic notes of all of our classes. And what that means is she's listening and involved in the classes and actually helping everybody understand the content of our class through these graphic notes. So for this particular class, we talked a lot about, this class was about the ABCs of IEPs and IFSPs. The reason is we're trying to help paraprofessionals have almost like a secret decoder ring to all of the stuff that in special ed we talk about really kind of without explaining to paraprofessionals. And so I know that one of the coolest parts for me of this class is how much the paraprofessionals are telling us we are so empowered now. We understand now what people are talking about. We talked about labels at the first class. In the third class here, we did IEPs. We explained the difference between IEP and an IFSP. We talked about the legal aspects of IEPs. And we talked about why our paraprofessionals sometimes not involved in the meetings, which was a really good discussion, I thought. We explained least restrictive environment. We explained the continuum of services. We talked through supplemental aids and services. So those were the big ideas. And one of the most fun things we're doing is having it graphically recorded so that we can go back and see what it looks like. Anything jump out to you, Christy, from that particular class?
Yeah, I think it was, I was trying to remember myself what I remembered from that class. I'm getting a little bit of an echo, sorry.
That's okay. Why don't we look at the Wordle? Because I want to explain what the Wordle is. So at the end of every class, we're asking paraprofessionals to put in the chat, how do they feel about today? What did they, you know, what was one word that represents your learning today? And we're just seeing, as if you know how Wordles work, the major word is informative. People are getting a lot of content in these classes. That was a Facebook message I got yesterday, which was, I can't believe how much content you're giving us in such a short amount of time. But we're seeing things like encouraging, enlightening, awesome, excellent, valuable, wonderful, important, and obviously informative, valued, awesome. The word valued, I want to just talk about for a second. We're hearing a lot of feedback from paras that are saying, I just feel so valued as a learner. And for me, that feels really good because that was Christy's and my goal at the outset. We designed this class because many paraprofessionals are at home right now and they're not working with kids in the ways that they're used to, that they used to be working with kids. And administrators are wondering, how do we use this time effectively? And our thought right away was, let's create this training to get everybody up and running so that when we go back to school, everybody is more trained up than they've ever been before.
Yeah, I think that's part of what we really wanted to make sure was that we took this opportunity to make sure that what I call the champions of inclusion were really ready and able to, whatever school looks like, that we knew that we had every member of our team ready to really be all in. And so we've talked about, you know, how to increase independence, how to lose labels, what's all about the IEP. And then today we talked about big emotions and behaviors that are challenging. So maybe what we should do is give a book away. I was trying to look on live to see if we've got some anybody's name dropping up here. So it might take a minute.
We'll wait Why don't we explain? If you're on right now, and we know that some of you are, some of you aren't, if you're on right now, please just say, hey, in the chat, because you might be able to win something. Or if you're live, you can just share a thought that you're having about this particular class. As you can see there, that's the book that we're going to be talking about. And you can win a book today through Brooks Publishing. And it's called The Paraprofessional's Handbook for Effective Support in Inclusive Classrooms. And so that's something we're going to be giving away. But we need folks to be in the chat letting us know you're here. Would be great. And if you don't win the book, there's a 20% off code. That, do you mind going to that, Christy? And so there's a 20% off code, perfect. And it's PARAPD20. So if you go through Brooks Publishing, you can get a 20% off this book. So if you don't win the book, you can do this now. Good. So Christy's putting it right up there.
Yeah.
Because you're a multitasker. You're doing great.
It's getting there. It's getting there. So yeah. So we wanted to give away some things today, which is Julie's handbook. Thanks to our friends at Brooks Publishing. Ashley will help in the chat to help you say I'm here, and we'll get it to you. It's electronic format or in print, or you can buy anything from Brooks with a 20% code because they're helping us spread the word. So, okay. So where does that take us then?
I was thinking about, as people are writing in the chat, why don't we talk about today? So Christy said that today, the class that we talked was about managing big emotion and supporting students who are having big emotion. And we started really teaching about the brain and what actually is going on in the brain for kids when they have big emotion. I said to Christy, please do the brain today when we're on live, because without prompting, paraprofessionals were like, that was amazing. That helps me a lot. My mind is blown. And so do you want to explain what we talked about today?
Yeah. So many of my fellow revolutionaries know this, but I think what's important about talking about it right now is that we're getting everybody to talk about it. So I was in Boulder Valley back when we could travel, and I did this with the superintendents. There's many of them in Boulder Valley. I did them with all the district heads and leaders, and we left the meeting and everybody was taking their hand and showing other colleagues right away what our brain looks like. And this comes from Dan Siegel, and just need one of your hands, and I'll do it pretty quickly because I know many of you revolutionaries know it. But I want you to know that this is the level of conversation that we're having, so that everybody who's supporting a student is on the same page, so that when we talk about doing away with behavior charts or sticker charts, that we're giving people what the replacement is. So you just take your hand and you put your fingers up, stick your thumb out, and then you go, okay, I understand all the parts of the brain. Down the middle of my hand, where if you're a palm reader, that is your lifeline, but that's also your brainstem. And so the brainstem is where we have behaviors that are fight or flight, freeze or faint. So that's what we talk about in terms of today. Julie asked them, what was the most challenging behavior? And Julie, what were some of the behaviors people said that they had seen in classrooms that were the most disturbing, pressing on their hearts?
Yeah, so there were 700 probably that came across, but it was really a lot of behaviors like, so people talked about hitting and spitting and biting and running and fleeing and shutting down and swearing and all those kind of behaviors that we are likely to see K-12 in our school systems.
Yep. So we add them all those. So imagine those behaviors. And then what we want to do is we want to have our lid on. So you put your thumb in your palm and you wrap your fingers around your thumb. And that allows you to basically make the shape of our brain, as Dan Siegel would say. And so what we do is we pull from different work, like Stuart Shanker at the Merit Center. And we talk about when we get hyper aroused or hypo aroused, we flip our lids. And that's what you see on the screen, where the four fingers are no longer wrapped around the thumb, but they have flipped into the air. And then we look in that middle area where the thumb is, and that's the limbic regions. And that's where there's a big, strong emotions, the hypothalamus, the amygdala. And we really want that thumb to be the brakes. We want that when the body says, I'm in danger, or I'm not safe, or something is stressing me out, we want that thumb to stay in place. And then we use our lovely paraprofessionals, our teachers, our parents to co-regulate. And that's what helps put the lid back on, or the fingers. But when the fingers flip and the thumb comes back out, that's when we're not our best selves. And that's when we get the behaviors that Julie was mentioning, the screaming, the biting, the refusal, the withdrawal, the confusion, the lack of motivation, all these labels that we give to children and students, when what we really want to understand is what's going on as a body's reaction to stress. And it's not a conscious, so a non-conscious response. We flip our lid, maybe the brake comes off, and then we're in fight or flight, freeze or faint. Mm-hmm. And that's what we talked about today.
Yeah. And that was really big. I think a lot of people were understanding. There was a moment, you said two things additionally today that I wanted you to share. One is that you said about five times per hour.
Per second.
Our brain.
Per second.
Oh,
per second.
I know. Five times per second.
You can't count that. Every second the brain says, am I safe? 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 It asks that five times every second.
Oh, I missed that. I was already impressed with an hour. So what that means is your body is simply constantly double checking that you're safe.
Triple checking.
And when five times checking. And when you're not safe, that's when you start to not be able to manage your behavior. The other thing you talked about is the look that a kid might give you. And so often, and I've experienced myself, where I think, is this kid doing this on purpose to me, right?
Yes.
And in reality, it is not a conscious decision.
Right.
And we did a lot with the paras today too, to talk about the times that we weren't able to make good conscious decisions around our own behavior. And for me, sometimes kind of remembering what that's like, even as an adult,
absolutely,
can be so helpful, because the next time I'm with a kid that's really having a hard time, I can be more empathetic, but also more kind and more willing to give that time and space. Yeah.
Otherwise, Julie, we think they're manipulating us or they're doing it on purpose and they're just yanking our chain. So really to understand that this is a non-conscious response, that it's the body scanning and saying, using past experiences. So if my past experiences, you're my paraprofessional, and my past experiences, you redirect me a lot. You're telling me a lot and you smell like coffee breath.
Right.
Right. All these things are my body are saying you're not safe. That's my past experience. It's going to use this current situation. You still are redirecting me and you smell like coffee. Right. And it's going to use my temperament. So it uses all of that data in a neural blink of an eye and decides, can the lid stay on? If the lid comes off, the limbic alarm has gone off, but I don't need to go to fight or flight, freeze or faint. I can deal with it. And I might use some sort of coping mechanism. So today we didn't get into that today, but people were talking about, you know, a kid who might whine or a kid might refuse. Sometimes that's their coping mechanism. It's a way to quickly get rid of the big emotion and makes them feel better, but it's a short-term fix. It's not a solution. So it's not a coping strategy is what my friend Alyssa Blass Campbell. So maybe, do you want to do the roller coaster? Would it make sense?
Yeah, I think just so you can get a little more of a flavor, we're doing a lot of what I'd call hearts and minds work back and forth. So we were helping paraprofessionals today really understand what happens for kids who spend a lot of their time in that fight or flight or freeze or faint mode. The example we said is, imagine that you were getting on a roller coaster with us today. Like you're sitting down on the roller coaster and down comes the safety bar. What is the first thing you're going to do when that safety bar comes down? And most people said, I will shake it. I will check. I'll double check that it's going to be safe, right? Oh, good. People are saying hi. I'm so happy to see people here. We've got Maria here and Giovanna's here. Ashley's here. Awesome. We're glad you're here. So you're sitting in this roller coaster and you would first check to make sure that your bar will hold. And what we explain to paraprofessionals is really you're the bar in this case, meaning kids come to school and they're close to fight or flight or completely in fight or flight, and they're double checking all day long to see who can hold for them. And what we meant by hold is who can be consistent, who can be warm, who can be loving, who can be safe, who can be nurturing every single time that they have challenge, that they get to a place where they don't feel safe. And it's not just for young kids. This is middle schoolers and high schoolers. And so when we put it in this context, paraprofessionals said, whoa, if I'm the bar, then it's not because they're mad at me. It's not because they don't like me. They're just testing to make sure I can hold over and over and over again. And the example is that we gave is that, you know, many of our students have roller coaster lives. They've had big ups and big downs. And they're more scared than we even understand or comprehend. And they're at such an alert level that their behavior is just saying, hey, who's safe here? Who's safe here? Who's safe here? And our job is to say, we are, we are, we are, over and over again. Yep. So Maria says, I always check my bar. Yeah, me too. If I were to get into a roller coaster, the truth be told, I don't really want to get on one.
Oh, I love roller coasters so much. But it was interesting today too, that when we ask people, what do you do? Some people, I don't know if you saw, Julie, but one person said they check their kids first, which I thought was really interesting, that like caregiving parent, you know, I'm going to check everybody and then check myself, which when you're dealing with big emotions, you always check yourself first. So that will be a big, they're going to have to do a big mind shift. And then we had said, I gave the example that when I first heard Julie talk about the roller coaster, I was like, duh, of course, everybody can check it. And my husband was like, you do? And I was like, yeah. And he was like, oh, okay. And then my friend Crystal today, when she was listening back to the video, she said, yeah, I didn't know what you would do. So I think it just speaks to how we all have different histories about our experience and how much we like the roller coaster. If the roller coaster has become our habit and we're addicted to the whooshing and the down and the ups, if the down and the ups are just part of our life, like all of that is really a metaphor or analogy, whichever it is, for how we deal with behaviors, with the stressors, and then what behaviors we see. Okay.
Yeah. And so I just want to add, Christy's, we've been putting this course together and it's been so fun. And I feel like it's a pretty magical course in that we're doing both mindset, like how do you think about behavior first and then strategy? And I think that's what we've been doing for like labels. How do you need to think about labels first? And then what are the labels so that you understand them? And then back to how do you still think about labels? And so I think the back and forth has been really useful for paras.
Yeah. Do you want to look at the course really quick? Does anybody want to see what it looks like? Let's see if we can do this.
This is so cool. This is what it looks like. So while you're getting there, Christy, when you buy this course, which is available for the first time today, this is finally all there today. You get these welcome videos of us here. Do you mind going back a little bit?
Yep.
Okay. So when they get on, they'll get a little welcome video from us that says, you know, who am I and what's my deal? And yours is who are you and what's your deal? Meaning kind of like, we talk about our own histories and why we're doing this work and why we're so passionate about inclusion and things like that. And then you want to explain that?
Yeah, so this is just because it's the word we use called asynchronous. So the work that the class that Julie and I just finished today was live. And so we were with these 700 paraprofessionals in real time. And now we're offering it what we're calling on demand or what some call asynchronous. So that means people can save it till next year, but they, you know, we only have registration open now for the next couple of weeks, but you have lifetime access to it. So we do things to orient them. So we tell them how the class is divided, that there's a private Facebook group where they can meet. We've got paraprofessionals from Australia, from Canada, from Alaska, from New Hampshire, Vermont, Ohio, Wisconsin, Colorado, Washington, Oregon. Florida. What else?
Did you say New York? That's the
New
question.
York. Sorry, of course, New York, right? Right. And so we want to get them all kind of connected. In the content, it's divided in several ways. So you can watch it, you can listen to it, or you can download a transcript. And so I'm ahead of myself, Julie, but that's what this is all telling them is mm-hmm. that there's different ways. Our PowerPoint, packets, what next?
Yeah, well, you go to class one just so that I'll just talk people through that. Okay, so let's imagine that you bought the class and you're really interested in just starting. So if you buy this today, you get this today and forever. And so you can watch the online session, the first one, which is really good. It's about making sense of labels. And then you get Cheryl's graphic recording of the whole thing. So people are really loving this and they're saying it's helping them to learn and helping them to take notes. And then you could just do audio. So some people were saying, I have been doing it like podcasts where I just want to go running or walking and listen. So that's all available that way. Like you said, the transcripts are available too. And you get all of these handouts. So it's the big packet of handouts. It's
key. I can't show that. Sorry. But yeah.
That's okay. And then key PowerPoint slides. And then we've put articles that are really useful. So as you could see, this first class was all about labels. And so we started to pull some articles that we think are really, really useful about thinking about and rethinking about labels. And then the second session is about helping students become more independent and interdependent. So not needing adult support as much. Is there anything we want to highlight from that class?
No, just the same thing. I just wanted you to see the same flow. But everything is there and ready to go.
Yep. And so we just wanted people to know it is finally actually available on demand because we had to finish the course in order to get it to be on demand. So it's finally on demand. And if people want to go to get the course, many districts are buying it for all of their paraprofessionals and they're using it really strategically because let's say you get it now, but you don't want to do any training in June because you want everyone to take a break. No problem. You still have it for July or August or September or whenever, but this is the way to get the content.
And I was going to try to get, I somehow closed it. We have a letter somewhere. I'll figure that out.
Okay.
I don't know where I put it, Julie. I've got too many things open now.
That's okay.
But just put in the, just watch this thread and I'll put the link to the letter in the Facebook thread that you can copy and paste it. The letter is to your superintendent, your principal, your director of special ed, your coordinator of early childhood that says, this is why this course would be important for me. Or if you aren't a para, but you're listening to this, you might help them and advocate on their behalf that this would be something. We did have coaches and teachers and administrators take the class alongside the paras so that they could facilitate conversations in between sessions.
Yep. That letter is really useful. So you'll just have to look in the chat and Christy will put a little link to it, but it's so that you can easily share this with your administrator and they'll understand what is this thing that you want and why is it useful and then exactly how to get it so that if possible, your districts can pay for this because they often have paraprofessional training money that can go right to this. So that's our hope is that it's actually your district, but then there are many, many paras that bought it on their own and there were probably five different times we heard this was so worth it. Like it was a value much bigger than the price of the class.
So should we give another book away? I don't know how we did that a minute ago. Or a course away. Maybe we want to give the course away to somebody that's live with us. Want the course?
Yeah. So that seems really fun. Should maybe we'll have, is Crystal? No,
it
is.
Ashley's on.
Ashley's on. Oh, there's the letter, everybody. Sorry to go back.
Thanks, Ash. No, that's the wrong letter. Thanks, Ashley. That would make sense. So just cat out of the bag, because Julie and I love this so much, we made a part two to the live event. So that letter is helping those 700 plus that were in the class right now continue their journey with us. And so I don't know where the one is, Ashley, that was really good problem solving, but it's kind of like that. It'll show you what the letter looks like.
Yeah, it'll be a start, but so that's fine. I think that the cat's out of the bag because people were so excited about the first class that we offered a second class, and that's called part two, and we'll talk to you about it later. But right now we're just talking to new folks about part one. If you haven't gotten into part one, it's now finally available for you. So that's pretty fun.
So we were going to give something away.
Do you want me to pick?
Yeah. I can't remember how we were going to do it.
Here's how I'm going to do it.
Okay.
I'm going to pick Giovanna Gottfried. You won and you get to pick if you want a free book or a free course, and you just need to email Christy and she'll tell you her email.
And
go ahead and tell them your email. Yeah.
I'm doing it.
Okay, down there. And so you just get to say, I'd like the course or I'd like the book, and that I was a winner, and congratulations. That's awesome.
And then, you got one more name there.
Yeah, let's do Maria Savage Matern. Maria Savage.
Yeah, Maria, we got.
Okay. So you too can win. You can pick the book or you can pick the course.
If you pick the book, you can pick electronic or paper. That's a lot of choices for a Friday afternoon.
It's a lot. But just to review, there's paper book, electronic book, or course.
Yeah. Easy. All right. Did we forget anything?
I think so. We're just super excited about it. So join us. Why don't you put one more time the link? Oh, it's not, you just did already. You're so good.
I can do it. It's all right. We'll put the link to register. Oh, I know where I could put it too. I had all this ready. Mm-hmm. But
are you going to scroll it?
Yeah, just because I can.
Because you know how. That's amazing. So this is where to go to get the class. And as soon as you register, you get everything.
Oh, the book. We should tell them the name of the book. We're just talking about it like we all know what we're talking about. I'll put the picture up again. Sorry.
I can go.
Show in the stream. Okay. Yeah, that's good too.
Yeah. So the Paraprofessional Handbook for Effective Support in Inclusive Classrooms through Brooks Publishing is the book we're talking about. And we're utilizing a lot of the information from the book, and it's just for paras about how to do the work of including kids with disabilities in general education classrooms.
And we're actually, Julie and I, more cats out of the bag. I don't know when it's going to happen though, because you keep coming up with all these other ideas. We're writing a handbook for early childhood paraprofessionals. So the course is pre-K through 12th grade. The handbook has been traditionally K-12.
Yeah. And so we're going to do just a pre-K version. Is that what you're going to call it?
I don't know.
Okay, we'll figure it out. But it's going to be all about early childhood and how do you do this in early childhood only for those of you who just want that. And you don't want high school examples and you don't want to hear about biology class. You want to talk about kids that are really struggling to be soothed and seen and supported in early childhood settings.
So perfect. Okay. Well, there you have it. Thanks for joining us on a Friday afternoon or morning or who knows what day it is or time. I've lost track, but it's definitely beer 30 here. You don't have to show me a beer or wine. I will just know what I need.
You know what you need. Okay, thanks, Christy. Thanks,
All right.
everyone, for joining us. Have a
Bye,
good
guys.
one. Bye.